Oh, is the sun shining today? Wow, it feels so great. Don't you feel like it's spring is actually springing now? It's sprung? Yeah, that sunshine. It'll be coming around the mountain when it comes, but in its own time. She'll be coming around the mountain when she comes. It's been kind of a long season. However, I am now witnessing the blossoms starting to peek out through their buds, and the magnolias are bounding forth and just showing their lovely and spectacular petals. And I made Neil promise me that today would drive down Abbott Street sometime during the day, because all of those beautiful magnolias and the tulips are dancing with every drop of rain that has fallen onto them. The grass is growing. We live downtown, and I've been hearing the city cut the grass and trim the trees, things that need to be cut. And I feel like this is an awakening time, spring. As Drs. Ken and Deborah Gordon said at Easter, spring is a time of rebirth, renewal, recommitment to our spiritual evolution and growth. So now more than ever, we are hearing that call, that higher call, to become even greater instruments of love, of peace, of healing on this planet today. And that journey begins for me within the mystical corridors of my own soul and you. So if you're ready to become that instrument by stepping into that greater yet to be, then join with me in consciousness of an abundant life this morning. Not just life, but an abundant life. Abundance is everywhere. Joy exists if we want to recognize it. Contentment, fulfillment, it's ours now if we choose. So let's just tease ourselves. Let's just tease ourselves with the endless possibilities of that in our own life. And what needs, ask yourself the question, what needs to be awakened, or what needs to blossom, or maybe what needs to be trimmed or cut out of your life in order to allow you to grow into an even more abundant and blessed life. Through this very teaching, this teaching of science of mind, through meditation, affirmative prayer, visioning, chanting, even yoga, reflective exercise and silent walks, all of that can touch your inner core of perfect wholeness. It can touch that radiant joy, that place where it resides, very deep inside of you, that peaceful contentment, because these are the sacred tools that are required for that soul devotion that I was speaking about, the journey of nurturing your soul. But remember, before you even think of beginning this journey, and it's a journey, y'all, because life, it's a marathon, not a sprint. Before you even think of beginning this journey, we must begin to know and become aware of who we are. And when you realize who you are, you have taken that first step that I was talking about. If you were to ask me who you are, I would say to each of you, you are the face of God. You, me, all of us, we're the face of God. You are the face of God. I hold you in my heart. You are a part of me. You are the face of God. You know it. Will you sing it? You are the face of God. I hold you in my heart. You are a part of me. You are the face of God. Ooh, you're so sweet this morning. This song brings to me that we as family, all of us, go through this journey. We are the face of God on this journey, that I am connected to you and you are connected to me. We are all part of this amazing trip, this thing called life, this abundant life. And this is the life with all of its trials and tribulations, traveling through all of these things as we go through opinions, beliefs, concepts, diagnosis, the setups, the breakups, the makeups, all of that stuff that is right there in the midst of all of that. There in the midst of all of it is a beating, that heart beating. And that beating is life. And it's whispering, it's longing, and it's telling you, you are here sharing the face of life with all of it. It was here all the time. It's been here all the time. All the time. And I love this beautiful awakening in this song written by Karen Drucker, Face of God. This awakening, this awareness You mean tell me you, being the great I am as part of you and me, and has been here all the time in me, through me, as me, for me, through all of it? I just want to say maybe next time you better speak a little louder, because sometimes I forget and I close off. But what a beautiful awareness, what a wonderful awakening when we begin to realize that we are and have never been alone. The great I am has always and always been with us, always, through all of it. In the Bible it says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I love this awareness, we are not alone. And what a beautiful confirmation. Again, this song is this thing in life we are in together. We are not alone. This center is a part of that wholeness. We come together weekly. We are members. We join. We contribute. We share. We receive. We give. And speaking of membership, if you have not already signed up for your membership, please do give yourself. This is part of that commitment to yourself, to come back into yourself and be part of that greater whole. There's a $50 suggested fee that we would love for you to offer, but I want you to know that as you're contributing that, you're giving back to yourself, because here we are on a Sunday and all of the other wonderful things that we share with you throughout the week at the center. The theme for this month is spiritual living through transformation and evolution. Well, I feel that we are, whether we recognize it or not, whether we know it or even accept it, that we are evolving. It's going to happen. It's a given, folks. But transformation, it's like I said, we must be aware. And today, as we talk about the joy of living, just say that word with me. Just say it, joy. Joy. Just feel, it feels good just to say that word. You just kind of smile. You can't help but smile. And as a vocalist, I want you to know that the oi sound, oi, is one of our most open positions when you make sound. So as you say the word joy, say it with me, joy. Feel how your throat opens up. Recognize your awareness around that openness. Speaking into that place, speaking the same awareness is the same thing that's going on inside your mouth, the attention that you're giving to your mouth. And just to demonstrate, I'm sidetracking here because this is the teacher in me now, the vocal teacher. Just to demonstrate, I want you to feel what happens when you take a breath in either through your mouth or through your nose. I want you just to be aware of that feeling and that sensation of breathing and that your soft palate is lifting. Take a breath. Are you aware of it now? You might not have known it before. Take a breath. That soft palate is engaging and lifting, and it is that breath that keeps us alive, obviously, but it is that space that creates an opening for us when we do it. It's the same thing when we acknowledge that space, that breath within, we are reminded of the love that is within us all the time. Meditation is awareness of a breath. To accommodate transformation, awareness is key. Awareness of clarity, setting clear visions. Here I go again. So it reminds me of the song, David, you just sang this not too long ago. I can see clearly. I can see clearly now, the rain is gone. I can see no obstacles in my way. You can sing it with me. Gone are the dark clouds that had me blind. It's gonna be a bright, bright, sunshiny day. I don't see someone singing in the back. It's gonna be a bright, bright, sunshiny day. Should we go on? You know what I'm talking about. When we feel that connection, that clarity, I want to talk about that song because as I'm sitting here, as I'm standing here talking to you, it brings joy, not just to spontaneously erupt into song, but to realize that your eyes are the mystical key and that they can be so deceiving and we can find ourselves caught up in so many things. We find ourselves caught up in the illusion and the mire that we can call life, and that we forget that there was and there is this presence and power with us all the time, whispering, you are the face of God. We can forget that there's so much more than what meets the eye. We can forget that there's so much more than the facts, the figures, the opinions, the concepts, all the stuff that we put in there, you name it. We forget that there's so much more to us. We are so magnificent. We're so amazing. And that is part of the abundance that I speak of. When I begin to see who I really am, all I can say is, wow. Because it's so beautiful, and I'm in such awe of this magnificent, amazing, abundant life that I'm living. And when I do that, when I see who I really am, when I am that face of God, that reflection, it takes out any stigma, any illusion that I am, you are, we are anything less of the great part of the whole in its entirety. So I like to sing that song, I Can See Clearly Now, to remember who I really am. I started a few minutes ago by having you repeat and sounding out the word joy. How simple and easy even allowing sound to come from you can create joy, or perhaps even a sense of opening, that feeling of extraordinary abundance and freedom. And that tune, the face of God that we sang earlier, that's a true reminder for me, for all of us, that we can remember that the omnipresence of God is with us always. We are never alone. We have opportunities to witness the face of God in everyone you meet, everywhere we go. And we begin to recognize and acknowledge that when we see the face of God, what we're seeing, what we're being, what we're having, what we're experiencing is love. The love of God. And that, my friends, my sisters and brothers, is what's going to keep us alive. God. To just rock my world. So some of you know, look at this baby. Some of you know that Mondays are my grandbaby days. Well, I try to make my time with them memorable and valuable. So as we're driving in the car while I have them captive so they can't run away from Grammy, I try to give them life lessons that I choose to think might support them in life one day. The kind of lessons I actually did try to give to my own children, but for my parents out there, you all know that it's not always easy when we're raising our babies because life is moving so fast and everything's happening, yes? Yes. But as a Grammy, I get to be there and be 100% present. And through this teaching, actually, I've learned how to do that. And I didn't have those tools when I was younger. So I'm so grateful for our young mamas out here today that know all this stuff. Well, Monday, as I drove Roman to school and his sister Rayma comes to me with us, I decided that the life lesson that I would share with them would be around the talk that I'm going to give today, a life that is abundant. And as you are well aware, when you are looking for great talk ideas, all you need to do is ask children why, because they are so profound and they have amazing insight and they know everything. So I actually put the question to them. I actually asked them, who are 7 and almost 3 next week, I asked them if they knew what abundant meant. And to my surprise, they actually did. Roman said that it meant we have everything we need, not like bikes and stuff, Bama, but everything we need, like a food and a place to live and family. And Rayma said, well, you all know from my stories, Rayma's just Rayma. She said the Easter Bunny's abundant. And she's actually right. She's actually right. But when Roman said abundance is everything we need, not what we want, I thought that's so profound and brilliant. And I asked Roman, where did you learn that? How do you know that? How do you know this at this age? And he said, in Africa. I learned it in the Philippines. I learned it in Mexico. My son and his wife take his children and they travel the world and they help others. They live a life of true service. And my grandchildren have already been exposed to so much life even at this young age. So when I asked them, could we create a list? I wanted to create a list that was a reflection of our personal abundance. And we made it kind of like a game. So we went around to each other and we were adding to the list. And I was slayed when the very first thing that Romy said was the very air we breathe. The topic, they're so smart. The topic of conversation went from bananas to apples and even life. And this is coming from the mouths of our babes. We had a number of items listed. We went through a whole bunch of things. And as the day went on, Rayma and I made lists. And when we picked up her brother after school, he had been thinking of it, obviously, all day. Because when he jumped in the car, he hopped in the vehicle. And the first thing he said was, Bama, love is abundant. I'm telling you, once we got out of the busyness of that school parking lot, I actually pulled over and I praised them for their awareness and their brilliance. And as we pulled over, I asked them, can you think of a time in your own life when you feel like you didn't have abundance in your life? And their answer was no. And I said, even in Africa, when you saw everything that you saw? And he said, Grandma, people there didn't have everything that we have. They didn't even have food or water. But they still felt rich because they felt the love of God. Wow. You heard me say earlier, when you're in awe of life, all you can say is awe. And wow. I mean, they get it. They know it. It's their natural. It's our natural state of beingness. And they know it. As we grow, we might forget. So we created this little song on that Monday and we sang it all day. And it kind of goes to the tune of Frère Jacques. Frère Jacques, and then there's repeat, Frère Jacques, dormez-vous? Okay, so this is what we did. Come with me. I have everything.
I have everything.
That I need.
That I need.
God is my source.
God is my source.
Life is good.
Life is good. So
we sang that all Monday. And to me, it was way better than singing any of the other tunes that are played out there in the world today. That song that says, nah, you don't have enough. You're not enough. It's on the radio. It's vlogging. It's blogging. It's on the media. It's everywhere we look right now. People are talking about what we don't have. But the babes know the truth. Bama, love is abundant. They understand and they get that it is their natural state.
I have
of
the
being.
Great honor and joy to introducing to you right now my favorite part of Soul Food Sunday is Mr. Neil Clausen doing the Science Corner.
Good morning, everyone. So for those of you who don't know what the Science Corner is, science of mind is a little bit of mind and a little bit of science. So Barbara does the heart, and I kind of do the science part of it. I was going to call it Skeptics Corner, because that's what I am, but it's kind of skeptics, kind of science. So, today's Science Corner, we're going to talk about molecules. We're going to talk about hydrogen, oxygen, carbon dioxide, and what happens when they don't mix and what happens when they do mix. But first of all, I was wondering if anybody happened to notice this Coca-Cola. Okay. No, this is not product placement. They're not paying us $100 to put their Cokes all over the stage. This is part of our experiment. Now, has anybody seen the Pepsi ad with Kendall Jenner that they pulled? Do you know the one I'm talking about? Where? Oh, you don't? Well, I don't. You have to YouTube it because it's pretty weird. They kind of took Pepsi and tried to make it the magic elixir to give peace on Earth, and it just fell flat the way that it worked.
No pun intended. Flat.
Yeah, no pun intended. So, and then beyond that, has anybody seen the Heineken commercial, where they get groups of people? So, in this Heineken commercial, they have groups of people. First of all, they interview them, and one of them is a homophobe, and the other is a transgender person, and one of them is a climate change denier, and another one is a. So they get these people together who are complete. The polar opposites. Then they put them in teams and they have to build something. So they're building a, you don't really know what it is. And then the second section, they just have to ask questions of each other. And the third section, they finish building this thing. And as they build this thing, they start to bond. And then, of course, they wheel out this Heineken beer and they say, now, we're going to play a video. And so, for example, the feminist has to watch the video of her partner and his negative views on feminism. And the climate science person has to watch his partner's view on science denial. And some of them are pretty hard, and they're looking at each other, and they can't reconcile that with the person they were just worked with. So of course, because it's a commercial, they have to give them a choice. Now, your choice is to stay and have a beer and discuss it, or just walk out. And Chris, free beer. What are you going to do? So they stay and discuss it. Ah, it's a beautiful thing. But it's a transformation. That's the beautiful thing about it, is they actually had these attitudes that once they met somebody who they normally would not mix with, there was a transformation. And I found that fascinating, because I'm going to come back to the bottle of Coke. Now, those who know me, and I have to be careful how I say this, know that I'm a Coke addict. It's very rare you're going to see me without a bottle of Coke. So I was thinking about this transformation and on a human level, and it also happens on a molecular level. And I'm going to tell you the interesting thing about Coca-Cola and how it's made, because I didn't know this. But what you've got basically is flavored water, which is hydrogen and oxygen. We know that. And what they do is it's mixed with carbon dioxide. Now, in a natural state, carbon dioxide and hydrogen and water do not mix. It's like oil and water. You pour one, you pour the other, they don't mix. They just don't. Yet back in the 1800s, they actually found a way that if you took this flavored drink and you injected carbon into it and then you put it under pressure, what will happen is the molecules will start to mix. And they'll start to mix together. So inside this bottle of Coke, you've got a transformation that is not natural. It doesn't happen in nature. So when you open the bottle, what happens is you're releasing the pressure, and then they start to split apart. And that's what the bubbles are. The bubbles start coming up, and that's what gives it the fizziness. Now, of course, if you just let it go after a while, then it goes flat. And that's because all the gas has come out of the Coke. So we're going to have a... Now look at the bubbles are coming up.
What a great sound, huh, Neil?
It is a great sound. In Mexico, when you open it, it goes, psst, and there's an actual, yeah. That's so much. And then, I wish I could do, you remember that Mean Joe Green, where they give him a Coke and he drinks the whole thing? Hang on. Mm. So the beautiful thing about this is we've got two things that should never mix together. Black and white. Left and right. Homophobes. Transgenders, people who shouldn't mix at all, and yet they do. And when they do, it's a beautiful thing. Thank you.
Thank you, Neil. You always have such a neat way of bringing it all together. The love and life of abundance is everywhere. We live in an abundant universe. It's everywhere. But let's not fool ourselves, folks. Let's not be deceived. We live in a powerful, abundant universe. So this morning, I want you to take a look. And this morning, I'm asking you to take another look and another look. And I'm asking you to ask the right questions. This morning, I'm asking you to stand in the midst of your situation, whatever it is, and say, wait a minute. Is this really true? I'm not alone. Wait a minute. Is this all that there is? Wait a minute. Begin to stand in the midst of these concepts and these beliefs and these ideas and opinions and statistics and everything that's been said about you and everything that's been in existence and take a second look. I don't know about y'all, but I've started taking a second look and I've had to ask myself the hard questions, not only what is true, but why am I holding on to these things still? You know those things that you become so entrenched in that prevent you from living that abundant life, that attitude of, this is my story and I'm sticking to it. What benefits, I'm asking you, what benefits are there to sticking to that old story? And then ask yourself the question, where did this originate from? Where did it come from? I've had to ask myself the hard questions. So I'm willing to discard and eradicate and erase all of this because we now know that and we remember that there's so much fun to be had. There's so much music to be created. There's so much life to be lived, so much joy. Every time you're stuck, just say joy. Feel the roof of your mouth opening up to create sound, and that sound is a reflection of that space that you've created for yourself to live. Why are we spending so much time hanging out with something or somebody that doesn't give us any benefit? Why are we spending so much time trying to set it right, this world, when our goal should be to see it right, this world? Love is abundance, Bama. We spend so much time caught up in this illusion that these eyes are only the lens, folks. It is the mind that sets and sees and conditions, ladies and gentlemen. Projections from our backgrounds, from our cultural projections. It's been colored, so to speak. And it's been mired. And it's been mired by our upbringing, the opinions of others, the ideas of what others think. We see what we believe. There's so much more to us. There's so much more to us. Use me, oh God, that I become an instrument. Let me begin to see beyond this physical sight. Use me that I might see into this universe, that I might see the abundance of this planet, because I can't just see with these plain old eyes compared to my grandchildren. I'm blind. I'm completely blind. They have brand new, fresh eyes. We've got to untrain them. That's what we've got to do. 53 years of training, and we've got to erase that. We live, and we move, and we have our being. I want you to know this. We live and move and have our being in something far beyond just this. Can we take a second look? Reconsider the gifts of a Sunday morning together? A Sunday afternoon, or watching the sunset over an ocean for those of you who have that great opportunity to do that, or singing in your car, or even in your shower, or sitting with your grandchildren at a table and just love, just love, just love, just simply being a human being. So before I leave you this morning, I'd like to read you a poem that one of my fellow ministers wrote on Facebook this past week. Many of you know Reverend Bob Luckin. He was here about 6 or 7 years ago. He's brilliant. He's an artist. He's phenomenal. He's one of my mentors. He wrote, you can close your eyes or leave them open. Just feel the I am that I am, where this is coming from. Love others. They are your breath of life. Love the past, the present, and the future. Be the child who falls to his knees from the power of his own laughter. Be the song every lover hears in the passion of a perfect union. Be the leaves on the tallest tree who long to fall and kiss the ground. Be the love that bends hard corners into hearts and clouds into pillows. Love the ego you have abandoned along with all of the disowned parts of yourself and others. When there is nothing you have not loved, lie down and sleep. Lie down and dream the dreams that lovers dream. When you wake, you will be awakened. Love everything you touch, everything you see, and most of all, love me. Love me in all of the many forms. I am the love that you were meant to be. What I know is that this is what I know, and it's God is enough for me. Is it enough for you too? Is it enough for you too? Bob, thank you. Let's do a speakeasy thing right now. Just powerful. Have you had a good morning? Are you inspired? Are you uplifted? Do you have tools to take on with you throughout the week to sustain you? Do you know you have a family, the spiritual family that is here to support you? Then my work is done. Thank you. Thank you for having me this morning. Dr. Deborah, thank you for inviting me to the stage. Thank you.